Hello and welcome to the Tweaking Talks 14 SP2 Bootcamp Sessions. In this session we would like to talk about the coding, and in particular to the API, the plugins, is deploy, is remote and is server. On the API, many to-do web services are removed. So also all the API 1.0, all the business logic is removed, and we don't no longer support or is deprecated the ASMX version as well. What is supported is still available on our documentation portal. You can also see the alternatives. If a method is no longer supported or deprecated, you can find it in the documentation. What is the alternative? On the API, some 2.0 web services were kept, so the majority was obsolete in the 2.0 web services, but some of them are only deprecated because we don't have a good alternative, and that is particular for the applications, for the CAT version, for some reporting and some workflow methods on the 2.0 web services. For the background task API, we introduced a couple of new methods there, like a create and a find. In a find, you can actually find the particular background task in the queue. It's also fully documented on our documentation portal. You can actually see a good description what the functionality is and what it does. On the API, we have done some fixes on the I metadata binding. So we found out during our implementation of the taxonomy sites connector that sometimes the URL was not responding and that gives some nasty system failure exceptions. And we actually now were able to detect it, and then we are actually throwing a metadata binding and the execution failure. And you can actually see bits handler it was that was thrown the exception. On the event monitoring, so the filtering on the user ID throws the input string was not in the correct format, and that is actually now fixed. For the annotations API, that is also introduced in the 14 SP1, we have an API for storing an API for storing and opening annotations. So it's actually an integration part and can also be seen as some kind of custom reporting. If you want to create it one, you can actually do that with this API. It supports creating, updating and retrieving of deleting annotations and only one level of replies. And also this API can also be used for a legacy migration with the collaborative review. If you want to know more about annotations, please watch the Collective Spaces functionality overview session. So the annotations API 2.5, like I said, it has support for creating, deleting and retrieve metadata. You can also update it, the annotation, and it's full support also for creating, updating and deleting of replies. We also make the change or added functionality is remote that actually calls this annotation API. So also from PowerShell, you can also create some kind of reporting for the annotations. And also the annotation API is also fully documented on our documentation portal. Also all the fields of the annotation API are also available, and in the 14 SP2 we make one change to the field change, so the fish published language change to CT annotation internal card, and it's actually filled then with a value from the object language. For the annotation API, it also works with the complete plugin mechanism that we have. So if you want to write some extra or intercept writing an annotation, updating it, you can actually hook in to this one and then actually write your custom code for that. And then you can actually do something for auditing, or you can send out notification to our other system. There are some limitations on this support for the plugin. So it's only triggered for creating and updating annotations. So for the create reply or update reply, there's no support for this to hook into those events in the write plugin mechanism. Where do you configure it for the annotation plugin configuration? It's actually in the normal XML write plugin settings. It's highlighted. You can actually see that there. You have to see for the is condition in there. In that one, you can define your sequence of plugins as well, what you want to do when an event happens. Talking about plugins now. So for the plugins, we actually moved away from the full framework and go to .NET Standard 2.0. Also, Microsoft is indicating that the full framework for .NET 8 is the last one. They only do hot fixes, and they will continue developing only on .NET Core. And that's also why actually we moved to .NET Standard 2.0, and .NET Standard 2.0 is supported by the full framework, but also by new frameworks like .NET Core or ASP.NET Core. So out of the box, all the plugins that we deliver are also .NET Standard 2.0. And also we will love to encourage you also, if you upgrade your plugins, also make sure they are now .NET Standard to be prepared for the future. So in the future, when we create new services, there's a good chance that that one is fully .NET Core or ASP.NET Core. And in order to run those plugins in those services, we have to make sure that the plugins is then a .NET Standard 2.0. To help you in the process of actually creating those .NET Standard 2.0 plugins or converting them, on the CD layout, we put in a plugin examples zip file, and if you open the zip file, you can actually see some examples there as well, how to create those plugins. And then in the, if you open the solution, you can actually see there are some plugin examples and also some unit tests for that actually you're using .NET Core, but also the full framework, so you can test both scenarios if your plugin is correctly working. Those plugins also have a little bit of an example documented as well. So how to install it, how to use it. And that can also be a base for you to configure your plugin as well. And saying which fields are required. And of course, this whole exercise of converting your plugins or creating new plugins based on .NET Standard 2.0 is also fully documented and available on our documentation portal. Something about isDeploy. isDeploy is actually released across releases, so when a feature is added, you can still use it on other platforms or older versions as well. So you have one isDeploy, but you can actually use it across multiple versions of Tridion Docs. It's still installed. You can still install it by an install module over the PowerShell gallery. And if you want to read the release documentation, it is still available on GitHub. So in the upcoming version, so the version 14 SP2, we also deliver or push out to the PowerShell gallery version is deployed to the PON. And it has now a dependency on the .NET framework 0.4.7.2. And it also internally, we also try to use to move to the way for going to .NET Core. So we using also .NET standard as well internally. So we slightly moving the direction as well. Is deployed to that one is also still working on Node Center 2016 and upwards. But you have to make sure that the .NET framework 4.7.2 is installed in order to work correctly with is deployed to that one. So what have we changed in is deployed in the upcoming version? So for the set is service full text index, we added some new features, so service port number pre-validation and also port number replacement behavior. And we removed adding firewall rules for the port as well. So that is easier to set up your full text index service. For the copy is file, we actually clear now the read-only flag of the copied file. And we fixed issues on the casing of the copied files. We have a special commandlet for the testing if there's a free port available. That's basically the name for test port in use to test is free port number. For, like we mentioned before, in a different session about content manager, we were talking about the TMS authentication behavior. So the set is the integration TMS has now support for setting the API key secret key, or you can actually set the credential. So it has support for both. And on the set is OS user, that one is now capable of setting the operating system user for all our services that are installed for 3D Docs. What you also saw in the previous session about the collective spaces, particularly the draw space functionality, that we can actually do some customizations on the behavior as well. And making those customizations, it involves lots of different steps. So we come up with a is deploy command that's called a set is Fonto schema experience that will first validate all the input parameters, get all the configuration files, also the catalogs and schemas. It does the validation on those as well. Then it actually starts a particular application of Fonto. So it will actually say, hey, compile this for me, and we get the result back. And that actually, we bundle it, and then we actually copy it back to the right locations. And also we have support for the XML normalization configuration as well. That's also part of the configuration of Fonto. If enabled, yes or no, we also updated in the webconfig settings of the author and the infoshare collective spaces. And after that, everything is done, we restart the collective spaces application pool. So if you do some kind of changes in the behavior, we really strongly recommend you using this is deploy command, because there are too many steps and you can easily forget one. For is deploy for review space. For review space, you can also use this one for enabling and disabling and configuring of the new Fonto review service. And if you use the set is OS user, it will also send those credentials of this particular server as well. The enable is UI collective spaces, that is extended with an extra parameter. And this way you can actually enable or disable review space. Is deploy document history. So for document history, we also added a couple of commandlets that you can actually enable or disable the service also the set is OS user, set also the right credentials on this particular service, and enable disable is UI collector spaces. There's an extra parameter added, so you can enable or disable the document history for draw space, and that is it will influence the what you can do if it's enabled yes no in draw space for your document history. More or less the same applies then also for is deploy for a Fonto Delta XML. There's also possibilities to enable or disable it. And also the set is OS user set also those credentials for the for this particular service. So an extra remark on the enable disable of the ish UI collector spaces. If you enable or disable it, we make changes to the collector spaces settings. We set actually draw spaces review space is enabled or disabled, and this setting is actually used by publication manager. So if you enable or disable, for example, if you disable review space, the copy link for review space, it's not there. You can only see then copy link for draw space. So that's fully working, not only for the UI, so not only draw space is enabled on the UI, but also available for in publication manager as well. For if remote, we create a new version in 0.11, and that one has some extra commandlets regarding for annotations. So you can actually add, remove, or get an annotation. You can set annotations. You can even also find annotations. So based on this is remote, you can actually go to the instance and actually retrieve all the information you need. And there's also, you can also think about creating some reporting for this role. We also have isServer, and that version 1.8 is released. And isServer is a PowerShell module to help you automate installation and configuration of prerequisites for 3D and docs. And what we added in this version is the ability to install for the Oracle provider for like the Oracle provider, but also the Microsoft ODB provider. It is released and published on the PowerShell gallery, and the scripts are also available on GitHub. This brings it at the end of this session. Please watch the recording of the other sessions as well. Thank you.